Tēnā koutou e te whānau, kua tā mai nei, tēnei pō, tēnā koutou katoa. Whānau mā, it won't take long to realise that I'm a bit rough around the edges. I don't do well in suits and I don't do well reading. And so there's five pages here. And so when Liam and Don gave it to me, I thought I'd better do it justice. And but before I get into the citation, I just wanted to mihi to the Mahuta whānau. I didn't have the privilege of meeting Matua Robert, but I wish I did. Simply because of the man that he was. And when I was reading the citation, a lot of the kupu come to life through a lot of the things that I've seen in the mighty Waikato that his hand's been a part of. And in preparation as I was reading it, I looked for two things. One, the words that I didn't know how to read, and I asked a few of the whānau here if they could help me understand some of those words. And two, particular moments. I'm a strong believer that in life, we're all average until we hit a certain moment. And those moments in life, if we make the right decision within them, the ability to propel our lives into different situations and achieve different outcomes is by the way that we respond in those moments. And as I was reading through, my favourite part of it, and I'll get to it, was when he met the late Lady Raiha Mahuta. Before everything there, he was just one of the cousins by the looks of it. And then ever since, she was either a hearty wahine or, you know, she did something there where it was very clear that there's a hockey stick action going on there. I thought about that and how many beautiful wahine I have in my life. And how I wouldn't be where I am, though I'm not anywhere in particular where I want to be. But it made me want to be a better husband to my wife and a better father to my daughters. And his example of being a man who respects womanhood in our wahine is probably the most thing I'm grateful for that he's done in his life. Yes, he's achieved some really cool things, but the person that he was one that I admire and one I'm grateful for that I get to stand on the shoulders of such a rangatira. As I forge my life and what I'm trying to do. So, ngā mihi nui atu kia korua. It's good to be here, and it's an honour and privilege to read this tonight. So, Sir Robert Te Kotahi Tanga Koe Oki Mahuta was born in 1939 in Tikuiti. At 4 weeks old, he was adopted by the 5th Māori King Koroki and his wife, Te Tairangi Kahu. Sir Robert grew up at Wahipa in Huntly, under the watchful eye of his great aunt, Te Puia Herangi, the Kingitanga leader. Education played a prominent role throughout Sir Robert's life, although at times it was a love-hate relationship. Despite his father wanting him to become a mechanic, Te Puia had high aspirations for him and was determined to ensure that he lived up to them. Sorry, sometimes I crack up in the middle because I think of my mum and like a lot of the stuff that I didn't want to do when I was younger, and it's just really cool like seeing it, you know, the whakaaro in the citation come to life. So forgive me if I pause and crack up a little bit at certain parts. While the other children played outside, Sir Robert would be inside, informing the elders about the happenings of the wider world. At an early age, his mischievous side emerged. So if he couldn't quite understand the words, Sir Robert made up stories about what was going on. Later, he was enrolled at Mount Albert Grammar in Auckland, an experience that he would later say was quite traumatic. Sir Robert could be stubborn at times and was determined to do things his way. His disillusionment with school in his teenage years caused him to drop out and work a variety of manual labour jobs, including the mines, the wharves and freezing works, and even doing a stint overseas with the army before being discharged in Dunedin. It was there Sir Robert met his wife, the late Lady Raiha Mahuta, and inspired by her success at school, enrolled himself in a night school to complete his school certificate. Sir Robert achieved that, surprising himself with good marks, and applied for a degree in anthropology at Auckland University the following year. He would go on to complete his master's and travel to Oxford University in the UK to study for his doctorate. He never quite got around to finishing his doctorate. The doctorate of his people were paramount and drew him back to his country. He always said he appreciated the work he invested into it as it provided him a theoretical background to approach many of the problems he would deal with later on in life. His time at Oxford would form the inspiration for the endowed college in Hopu Hopu, the powerhouse of trouble, strategic thinking and critique. Sir Robert's legacy is kept alive through the next generation of leaders. Graduating from the college today, and as well as the University of Waikato, where he was a founding director of the Centre of Māori Studies. Sir Robert's adopted sister was the late Dame Te Atairangi Kahu, and the two of them were quite close, despite growing up independently and separately. When Dame Te Ata initially succeeded her father, their relationship became strained because they had different ideas on which direction the kingitanga should take. Sir Robert believed she wanted to take it in a much more Pākehā way, or he wanted to stick closer to their Māori side and the Māori principles which the movement was founded. Thankfully, their paths merged and both settled on more comfortable leadership roles. Dame Te Ata as the ceremonial leader and Sir Robert as the fixer. The combined leadership of the two siblings would guide Tainui through periods of momentous change. He wasn't entirely sure when the spirit of transformation and activism entered him, but Sir Robert's first foray into iwi politics concerned a 1946 settlement claim between his aunt Te Puia and Pete Fraser, the Prime Minister of the time. When he wanted to renegotiate the settlement, Sir Robert found himself clashing with the elders of the Tainui Māori Trust Board, who viewed it as countering her achievements. This wasn't the case at all. Sir Robert simply knew it had been the best deal available at the time, but times had changed, and inflation alone meant the original settlement deal had devalued by 50%. So ignoring the naysayers, Sir Robert marched down to Wellington and demanded a better deal. His force of will and power of persuasion was successful in securing a promise from Duncan McIntyre, the deputy principal of the day, that for every dollar Tainui put into investment properties in Hamilton, the government would match it with $2, a pretty good return for the times. Unfortunately, the elder members of the Tainui Māori Trust Board were opposed to the proposed deal, seeing it as a dishonour to Te Puia, causing the deal to fall through. This experience would be invaluable for Sir Robert later and help him form his philosophy of business. He was always a big believer in trusting in his people. When Te Ata succeeded the throne and was looking for a project to make her mark, the idea of building a brand new dining hall at Tūrangawaewae in honour of Te Puia resurfaced. Te Ata asked Sir Robert if he would take charge of the project, and he agreed, but essentially said it would be done his way or he wasn't doing it. Everyone agreed and promised to let him take the helm, which worked out fine until the project was costed at $750,000, a huge amount at the time. Everyone argued that first they should fundraise the money, then build it, not Sir Robert. He knew that if they took a loan and built it first and then asked the people to fundraise, it would get done. By trusting his people and giving them something real to touch and experience, he knew they would come together to meet the challenge. And they did. Banding together in one great effort, they managed to raise the required funds and open Kimiora, whare kai free of debt. Today it still stands as one of the most historic buildings in all of Māoridom. In 1972, Sir Robert was appointed Director of the Centre of Māori Studies at Waikato University and is directly responsible for the program being what it is today, with a focus on action research. Sir Robert was a practical man and truly believed in living life out amongst his people, not hiding away in a library, although he loved nothing more than a good book. In 1983, he co-wrote the Tainui Report along with his friend Ken Egan, which was a first for Māori. The report allowed Tainui to begin to see a path forward to a future they wished to create for themselves. And Sir Robert met with many young leaders from iwi around Aotearoa and taught them to do the same. It was during the Coal Corp debate in the late 1980s that Sir Robert saw the opportunity for real change to occur. A catalyst for progress in the Raupatu settlement claim. After the court appeal ruled that the Crown must listen to the work with their treaty partner, Sir Robert saw that it was time for the real negotiations to begin. The Crown wanted the coal, the iwi demanded Raupatu, and Sir Robert was going to make sure they received it. Muldoon's national government made the initial approach to no success. Then Longi's Labour government came in and tried their best to wriggle out of the court appeals ruling, but Sir Robert would not back down. When National got back into power in 1990, With Jim Bolger at the helm, the climate had become much more receptive and negotiations could truly begin. Sir Robert and his team travelled to Wellington on a monthly basis to hash out the terms of the settlement with the Minister of Justice at the time, Doug Graham. After a few months of this, an exacerbated Doug, Doug asked him to quit horsing around and to put some numbers to the negotiation. Stubborn Sir Robert would simply counter with, "There are no numbers. It is just the land. It's just that the land was taken, and so land should be returned. Now you think about that, Doug, and how you're going to achieve it." Eventually, the figure of $170 million was offered in cash and assets, provided Waikato Tainui released their claim to the coal. Sir Robert countered with, "Well, okay, provided you pay interest immediately, and we remain the first cab off the block with no other claim before being more than the total awarded to us." Doug Graham and Jim Bolger agreed, and finally, after decades of debates and negotiations, a Raupatu settlement was reached. The historic deed of settlement was signed in 1995 at Tūranga Wawae by Dame Te Ata and Prime Minister Jim Bolger. It would be the first of many Raupatu reparations by the Crown to tangata whenua and included a formal apology from the Crown, a first for any Indigenous people who suffered injustices by the British Empire. Queen Elizabeth gave the royal assent to the subsequent Waikato Raupatu Claims Settlement Act with Te Ata and Waikato Kaumātua. It was the first time a British monarch had ever apologised to Māori, and it still is, and is still the only piece of legislation signed in Aotearoa and in public by the Queen. Sir Robert took a back seat to the business of the iwi after this, preferring to let new blood and fresh faces tackle the challenges of tomorrow. In June 1996, he became the first person appointed a Knight Companion of the New Zealand Order of Merit in recognition of his services to Māori whānau. Sir Robert was invested with knighthood in May 1997 at Tūranga Waiwai. He sadly passed on February the 1st, 2001, at the age of 61. Sir Robert was a transformative leader, one whose legacy has forever shaped the direction of our country. He believed that there are two qualities that every great leader must possess. The first is accountability. Accountability to the people that trust you to lead them and to deliver on promises you make to them. He believed you should not need outside experts to come in and tell your people how to act. They should be able to see that clearly for themselves. The second is vision, possessing a clear vision of the future, one that is beneficial for all, but tied to the ability to develop and implement a plan that will bring that future about. We are deeply honoured to be inducting Sir Robert into the Waikato Business Hall of Fame this evening. We want to leave you with a quote from him, one that encapsulates the kind man he was and his viewpoint of the world. "In one sense, all that we have to offer the future is the past, containing as it does the hopes, the spirit of determination of the people, their constant example, both of virtue and of error. But what a treasure chest that really is, that is brightest enough to guide the way ahead." I would now like to invite Sir Robert's whānau to the stage to receive the Waka Huia on his behalf.
I ngā mana I ngā reo I ngā karangatanga maha tēnā koutou. E tame, nā ui tūwhira tēnei huihuinga tangata, I roro I ngā whakaaro o a tātou nei mātua tūpuna, nō reira, nei te mihi mai oha ki a tātou katoa. The Right Honourable Jim Bolger, Joan, Sir Dryden, Lady Marg, we are immensely proud and deeply humbled that our Father has been acknowledged with you tonight. There are many things that you said that I think I should come back to because there are many similarities. But can I acknowledge all the distinguished guests that are here tonight, local government leaders, my parliamentary colleagues, business leaders, community leaders, and people who are doing things to make our Waikato region a better place. My sister and I were driving here tonight and we thought, well, would Dad actually come if he was still alive? And we kind of thought, nah, he'd probably send us. And then I kind of had a little quip with Sir Dryden at the door when I came, and I said, we did wonder whether or not Dad would come if he was still alive. And he said, of course he would. He'd always do the right thing. When I heard the descriptions of the leadership that you both share, there were so many things that you had in common as men of your time and legacy leaders. And I think the history that was outlined by Right Honourable Jim Bolger really set in trail the level of connection that, whether or not you knew it, you had an affinity to this region. Whether or not you knew it, your love of land and your love of ensuring that people were better off when they used land, there's something there. But it wasn't until you spoke, Sir Dryden, and you talked about doing your homework, surrounding yourself with really good people, more often than not probably people who knew more than you, as you said in your own words. Our Father was like that as well. He always believed that doing your homework really mattered. He loved being well-read. He loved showing off how well-read he was to all the people that were around him. He also had ambition. And his ambition was an indomitable spirit for the well-being of his whānau at Wāhi, his people of Waikato and the Waikato region, and then for New Zealand. And that's something else you both shared in common. What people might not know about our Father is that in being well-read, he also knew that he didn't know everything. He believed that quite strongly. But he understood the importance of comparative examples and looking elsewhere for solutions to common challenges. And in that effort, we observed as his kids his passion to learn from others and their comparative experience and glean from that experience what we might gain if we started to adopt some of that thinking. So you know the whole conversation around competitive advantage. There were a whole cohort of young people that Dad mentored during his time, and they knew him as RTM. And he would dish out books to them, and he'd say to them, I want you to read this book and come back to me and let me know what you learnt from it, and then let me know how applicable that is to what we're experiencing here within the tribe and how it might help us. Some people to this day laugh about the books that they got, but Michael Porter and Comparative Advantage, that's the book I got. So when you raised that, it just took me back to those salient lessons. Our Father was known as Sir Robert, mainly to the business people and the politicians that kind of had a knowledge of who he was. To those who really knew him, called him Bob. To those who he mentored and the team that he grew during those times that you heard about during the treaty settlement episode, they knew him as RTM. And back home at Wāhi, they knew him as Bubs, because he was always treated as the baby of the family. He never acted like it, though. I think he acted as if it was the oldest. But in all those references to him, you got a sense that in all his achievements, he was just a man who wanted to do more, be more, and ensure that there was more to life than just, you know, the treadmill type of way of being. There's something else that characterised the recognition of the two men that we are rightly recognising. They shared vision. They share vision, a vision of being in a better place. And I can say, having now heard Sir Dryden That is something you absolutely have in common. Values, when you have values, they're unshakable. Wouldn't matter what challenge you face, when you've got strong values, you can orient yourself towards the destination in a way that is very certain. Courage. Both of you shared courage, because I don't think you were liked all the time. And those are the people that you worked with. And neither was our father. But it didn't dissuade him from going down the path where he knew people needed to go, even if it wasn't popular. And I'm sure those are the stories that you would both relish in if he were here tonight. Conviction, because with courage does come conviction. And when you've got values to orient the way, the destination that you've got go to, then conviction that comes through as a strong part of your inherent character. And I think only those who know you most will be able to speak to the level of conviction that they've witnessed in the difficult times. And then there's relationships, because in all good business transactions, I think relationships absolutely matter. And, you know, we're just thankful that social media wasn't around during the time of our father. He would have been terrible. And his good friend Denise Henare would be defending him against defamation. I'm sure we're absolutely sure of it. But relationships do matter. I reflected on the story that you told about being in Russia, and we had a quick conversation, me and my sister, and we laughed. And we said, geez, before turning that down, Dad probably would have wondered how much could I get on the market for it. Humour is the other thing. Our father had great humour. And I think in some of the difficult challenges that we witnessed him facing with his own people, but also with other politicians and during some testy times of political negotiation, one of the greatest qualities and virtues he had was the ability to laugh at a situation. Because if he didn't do that, he'd probably thump his head 20 times over as to why are we in this place. But his humour cut across a lot of things. I have felt for a long time that much of Dad's story is intrinsic to a number of aspirations for this region. Firstly, our region has always been a region that has been sought after because of our fertile lands. And for Waikato, for a very long time after confiscation, the Waikato tribes had no idea of how to develop our land. Yet now, as a result of the settlement, the tribe is a property developer and now contributing to how this city will evolve over the next 10, 20, if not 30 years, because we are committed to this region like you are. I've also reflected on the issue of education, and Ezra was right. The good thing about my mother was that she stuck at her education. Our father left Mount Albert when he was 14 and then went to the mines. But were it not for my mother and her absolute belief that education would be the pathway to help not only our father, but our family and our tribe move forward, that became quite a solid pillar within our father's leadership, hence the establishment of the Waikato College for Research and Development, and setting a horizon there for the tribe to aspire to say we should be going into a realm of education where we are drawing on our own knowledge, that of other Indigenous people, sharing that and using it as a basis for development. Now, he had a lot of sayings. And in that regard, for education, he would say there can be no research without development, no development without research. And what he meant by that is education shouldn't be just for an academic exercise of gaining a qualification. It should always contribute to the betterment of communities and peoples. And that, at the heart of his sense of education, was what he learnt from our mother, and we are deeply appreciative to her for instilling that in him. Because you all know, he left school at 14, then went to work for in the coal mines in Huntly, lied about his age, went to Malaya, came back to Otago, met our mother, and then got a school C at the time when he was 23. So there was a lot of living done in between then. But Ezra made a point There are points, times in your life where it starts to teach you things, or you become defined by that experience. All that time in between, when our Father journeyed on the pathway of life or the school of life, we are under no shadow of a doubt as a family. He got taught the most salient lessons about his character, who he was, what he was able to achieve, and that is why he had ambition, was confident in what he had to contribute to his community and to his people, and absolutely excelled in the knowledge that he could do things because he had a vision and a dream. And we know all of that experience really built the person that he was. The other element of his leadership, I believe, is the reason why he's getting recognised tonight, is because it was never really ever about him. The other great passion that he had was for the kingitanga. And the kingitanga was a point of, was a place for him to feel that there was purpose in what he was contributing to, and that there was legacy that he was contributing to, and that legacy was bigger than he was, and he knew that he was just a small cog in that wheel. His passion for the Kingitanga movement and what it represented over generations and leading into the future meant that he could aspire to contribute to something bigger than himself that would endure the passage of time. And if his leadership is being recognised because underneath everything that he did was a sense of belief that the kingitanga would see the elevation of aspiration for his people, then we thank you for recognising his contribution. Dad believed that if you restored an economic base back to Tainui, then Tainui would demonstrate what they could do for the rest of the country. And he said it like that. You know, it's not just about Waikato, you watch. When the point was made that the political negotiating point around, as land was taken, land should be returned, and 1.2 million acres were taken, Dad was quite agnostic about where that land was going to come from. We thought, well, of the 1.2 million acres that were taken, 2% that was left and returned under the settlement, Dad started to think, okay, what if we started to purchase land in the South Island? Or dare I say, you know, further afield, beyond New Zealand. He had a strong view that we just needed to get into a more proactive space of building our economic base. And when I think about what the tribe is doing now and what Dad would say, he'd be absolutely proud, Hinarangi and Parikawhia, about the way in which the tribe has committed itself to focus on property development. And I know that it's been difficult because we're a heavily invested tribe in property, but the fact that the tribe is now talking about how to partner in growing the CBD, how to partner in growing housing for ourselves but the broader community, how to ensure that we are attracting people alongside other property development investors into our region, I know he'd be absolutely proud. So thank you both for your leadership. Lastly, Dad was surrounded by good people. There's no doubt about it, our mother being one, and the people who helped him achieve many things. And special couple of mentions tonight, and I could name a number of people, but Denise, for you to be here tonight, understanding the amount of support you gave him during those challenging times, you honour our father in ways you couldn't even begin to imagine. Thank you. And Shane, you represent the young bucks that bumped their heads helping him negotiate. These were during the years when Jim Bolger was Prime Minister. You couldn't just fly down to Wellington. So we were the drivers. We used to have a mattress on the back of a car so that Dad could sleep. We'd drive him down. He'd get up, do the business, negotiate. And then one of the drivers would have a sleep so the other one could drive him back. the next day to do stuff. That's how he lived his life for his people. And we saw all of those elements that were in admiration of his absolute commitment. But we were his kids. We were his kids. We saw him as a father. We saw him as a negotiator. We saw him as a husband. We saw him as a terrible rugby league mate. He was really rough. We saw him as a rugby league mate. We saw him as a mate to his own generation. And, you know, we are very proud as a family to have known him, to have known the quality of his leadership, to have known that alongside him there was an ilk of leadership that for your time you have all made New Zealand a much better place. And that's why you're getting recognised tonight. So thank you, Sir Dryden, and your family. Thank you to the Waikato Chamber of Commerce. Thank you to all Dad's friends, colleagues, and partners who have known him over a period of time for being here and sharing this awesome, awesome recognition of him. Nō reira he iti taku iti, I roto I te nākau nui. I'll leave you with a saying, because as Matuatame said, that we often draw on those sayings, those legacy sayings, to bind us together. But if tonight recognises anything, there's a saying of Portito that went, there's only but one eye of the needle through which the red, the white, and the black thread will pass. Hold on to te ture, hold on to faith, hold on to aroha, hei aha te aha, no matter what. And in that saying, I would say for tonight, we are intrinsically tethered together in a common purpose, that we love our region. We understand that there is a great purpose to foster leadership excellence. And when we do that, we can only but succeed. Nō reira, tēnā koutou katoa. Kia ora.